Okay. Now, where does all this lead to? Does it really make economic sense? That is what the next few slides will tell you. So, here are the three contenders. You have a luxury car. Okay, this is a CLO, which was at that time one luxury car, but now it's not available. Daewoo was the company which made this car. And then you have this Skyship 600B. And then you have Tata Sumo. Okay. So, when you do a cost benefit analysis in transportation, essentially what you do is you look at the various costs and the various benefits, and you try to get a monetary value of the benefit, remove it from the costs. The net cost can then be compared. Now, what you do is you convert everything into monetary units. It's not very easy. Things like cost of fuel, the charges to be paid to the driver, etc., you can work out. But how do you look at things like you have saved so many hours? What is the money equivalent of that? This is called as value of travel time saving, value of travel time. Now, value of travel time is a huge research area in transportation. Let's say if I ask you, okay, what would be the value of 1 hour reduction in your travel time when you go from a place to another place? Let's say you are doing this yatra. Okay. Or if we don't go to this yatra, because many of you might say, I don't want to do this yatra. Why are you making me do this yatra? Let's say from wherever your hometown is to IIT Bombay, you travel today by a mode of transport, say train. It costs so much. Suppose I give you some other alternative which saves you 3 hours of time. So let's say the journey is 10 hours and you reach there 3 hours early. What would you put as the value of the saving? In short, what is the value of 3 hours of your travel time? So think about it, and I want a number from you. So many rupees is the value of my travel time. I also want you to think and tell me on what factors does this number depend. First of all, will it be the same number for you and for me? It may not be. So what does it depend on? Why will it be less for me and more for you, or vice versa? So does somebody have any number? How many rupees per hour? Yes, let's get some number. Yeah, let's have a number. 1000 rupees per hour. On what basis do you get this number? Okay. So, but how do you say 1000? Why not 500? Why not 1500? Yeah, so that means what you are saying is 1000 rupees is the ballpark, so 500 is less and 1100 is more. Once you fix the number, then you can say more or less. But how do you get this number? Feel aa raha hai, toh feel can also be 2 rupees per hour. There has to be some way of giving the logic. Okay, if you can't have the number, tell me on what basis will this number depend? So what do you do with this 3 hours saved? Okay. So as you said, these 3 hours, I will give it more to my family. So he has valued as 1000 rupees per hour. That is a questionable thing. We don't know. It could be too high, too less. But one thing is, what do you do with that time? Now, if you are a Vela fellow, you have nothing to do. Okay. You will say 3 hours more. What is the big difference? So many of us take an indirect journey. We take a flight ticket. We go to Mumbai to Bangalore. We say direct flight, or Mumbai to Delhi is an example. Okay. You take a direct flight, it costs so much. There is another flight which is via some city to our halt and it is much lower, you will say, oh, chalta hai na, kya farak hai? No problem. How does it make a big difference for me? Because that money saving is more important to you than, you know, reaching in 2 hours. Suppose it takes 4 hours to go to Delhi instead of 2 hours. It should not be a big deal unless you have something so important there that even 2 hours you cannot wait. Correct. So there is a huge body of research on value of travel time savings. It is different for air travel, it is different for pedestrian travel, it is different for road travel, bus travel. When you design a metro in a city, right? For example, we have this metro which connects from Ghatkopar to Warsaw. So how many people will travel from that particular place to that particular place? Today they travel via Andheri and then take an auto. How much will they save? One important aspect is what will be the time saving. Then you look at comfort, you look at connectivity. So whatever method you use, that is a matter of debate. And there is a huge, I mean, when I teach air transportation, I take 2 classes on only VOT estimation. So we will discuss about it offline. But it is important that this value of travel time saving should be considered to get a proper comparison. Okay, so now let's look at the assumptions that we made in this study, because these assumptions will have to be considered by you. Okay, so first thing is that this analysis is specific to only Chardham Yatra. Okay, you cannot use it for Mumbai to Shirdi kind of a travel also. No, that is a different market and a different analysis will be there for that. For Chardham Yatra, which happens only from May to November, but the airship and the vehicles that are purchased, they will not remain idle from December to May. Maybe in December you will have a maintenance, 1 month maintenance, but January, February, March, April, you will not say, no, no, there is no passenger coming, so just keep sitting. Nobody can keep or afford to keep transportation systems idling. So we assume that they will be off season, will be used in some other areas. For example, January to March or April, it could be the Golden Triangle Circuit, Jaipur, Jodhpur, Delhi, that area, a lot of people come. So we are not assuming that the total cost will be recovered only in these months. Okay. As I mentioned, distance to travel by road is 7 days, because you are going to travel around 200 kilometers per day, which is a lot in hills actually. A typical average speed in a hilly area, I have traveled myself extensively in, at least in the Kumaon area, is not more than 30 kilometers per hour. That is the average you get if you don't stop. But after every 3 hours, you would like to stop for a cup of tea, for a snack, or just to rest, just to stretch your limbs. So practically, it only comes to 20, 25 kilometers per hour. So 200 kilometers per hour means 10 hours in a day you are traveling on the road. That's a lot, but that's the upper limit. Okay. Now, basically we are competing now between airship and luxury car, because travel by airships will not come very cheap. It will be expensive. So it is, so who are the people who will take it? People who are hiring a luxury car today for that particular route. And then in between, we bring in also SUV. Or Tata Sumo. This is what common people will take. So, as I said, no existing airship can do this route. So, we make an assumption that an enhanced version of Skyship 600 with 13 seats. Unfortunately, we do not at this point of time, at that point of time, sorry, this was done in 2002. Na? So, at that point of time, we did not have so much knowledge about airships. Nobody at that time, at least none of us at that time, knew what it will cost to make an airship to meet this requirement. So we had to make some assumptions. One can challenge them. Today we are in a much better condition. So if we are transporting 130 people per day and each airship can take 13 people, there are 10 airships required to be. And each airship will come with the ground support equipment. And 200 hours per month is what we fly the airship. 25 days, so we don't fly every day. We leave a few days for bad weather or break. And 8 hours a day is what, you can do it in 7 hours, so it's 8 hours a day is the total time. Okay, the cost benefit analysis was done for 8 years. So we assume that the airship life is 1800 hours. So after 8 years, you know, the airship is now going to be completely depreciated. Right? Now, regarding infrastructure, we said, okay, let's invest 5 crore rupees in building a hangar at Haridwar. And for every airship, apart from the initial cost, there will be 2.25 crores for the support equipment, the mast, etc. These numbers are not assumptions. These have come from actual quotation. Okay. So today one might say 5 crores is too less for building a hangar. Okay. But at that time, we made some inquiries and got this number for building a hangar of the size that an Skyship 600 needs. Similarly, depreciation of 10%, and to buy these airships, one has to take a loan, and that loan will not come free. So we assume 15% interest on reducing balance for taking that particular loan. Okay, then this was the cost side. Now the benefits or the income side. So we are assuming that this company which operates airships would definitely like to operate with a 10% profit. Nothing wrong in that, because this profit is what is the attraction to the investor, and a part of it will be invested back in the business, right? So airship is going to fly with a huge envelope, much bigger than cars or trucks. So you can paint it with something. We assume that you can charge this amount per day for revenue towards advertisement. Then by some calculation procedure, we got the value of travel time as rupees 145 per hour, as against 1000 hours of my friend. The travel time benefit was considered to be only 145 rupees per hour. Okay. And therefore, the intangible benefit per person per trip is going to be rupees 7000. Luxury car, so 3 people in the car plus driver. Okay. 40 cars per day, hence 280 cars per week and 4 trips a month, because each trip takes 11 days. So you can do cyclically and you will be able to do this way. Now at that time, the fuel cost per kilometer was worked out to 6.5 rupees per kilometer, and plane area was 5 rupees per kilometer, and we gave driver rupees 200 per day, plus we got some revenue from rentals also. Similarly, Tata Sumo, now here you can put more people. Okay. So we travel regularly with the Innova and we go 6-7 people. So it becomes tight with 6 people. But in hills you will find that people travel in these vehicles with approximately 8 people in the vehicle. So we took 7 people. Okay. So 18 vehicles per day, 126 vehicles per week, 4 trips a month. Fuel costs are lower. Per person, per kilometer fuel costs are much lower, and driver also gets less money, revenue also is lower. So this is the general map for doing the cost benefit analysis. So the costs are the cost of the airship, and then the operating cost, and then the cost of the infrastructure. The benefits or the income will be the advertisement, travel comfort, hence some premium, savings in time, hence value of travel time, off-season revenue when you apply it to some other place, and revenue from operation or the fare that we charge. So you take these numbers, take them, project it to a particular year, and then you can get a comparison. So this is the actual data which we got from the US airship, Skyship 600B. This is in US dollars. So the cost of the airship was 5 million. Utilization, pilots, ground crew, insurance, fuel, maintenance, support, ticketing, depreciation, blah, 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 blah. It comes to, the fare comes to $2.3 per kilometer. So when you operate this airship in an American scenario, with 10% profit, it will cost the operator $2.30 per kilometer. Okay. Now, Now we bring it down to the Indian conditions. So the cost is the same, $5 million, but converted into lakhs. Utilization also is very similar. So at some places, looking at the cost of manpower, etc. in India, again we got the fare of ₹36.9 or ₹37 per kilometer. So per kilometer travel, per passenger, you have to pay $40 if you travel by airship. Okay. So then this is the initial data about the airships. Okay, I have already mentioned to you a few numbers, like the number of the capacity, then consumption of fuel, 6 million, 1 million more because this is going to be further improved upon. The basic airship is 5 million, but the enhanced airship is 6 million because there are enhancements to allow it to operate at higher altitude. Okay, then here is the breakdown of the annual operating costs. I will not spend too much time. These are numbers which you can see at leisure. We have spreadsheets which contain all these calculations. Look at the DOC per seat per trip. So in an SUV or in a public transportation system, you are going to have, you know, something like, now this is in $1,000. So if I multiply this by 1,000, I get 36.7. So a passenger pays around $36 or $37. For a trip without any profit, etc. This is the kharcha or the expenditure that is done. On the airship, luxury car $113, more than what is spent, because there are 7 people there, there are 3 people here. So the operating costs are divided by 3 and by 7 there. For the airship, it is going to be $712, 711.9. So you will spend a lot of money. But if you look at the revenue, if you look at the investment, etc., you find that to break even in the SUV, you require just 8 years. So somebody puts money, buys SUVs, runs this business, everything goes well. In 8 years, you require the full money, assuming very little profit. For luxury car, you need 18 years. For airship, you need 14.61 years. But in this analysis, this is purely and purely on the basis of the no benefit for travel time and no advertisement, etc. Basic. Okay. So this is in lakh rupees. So if I change the numbers slightly and if I bring in little bit of other numbers, it so happens that you can break even in just 3 years instead of the 8 years. This particular graph comes with the additional revenue. With luxury car, you need one more year. With airship, you can do it in the first year itself, because you can earn a lot of money in airships with other facilities like advertisement on the balloon. And you can charge a premium for travel time saving and comfort. Okay. So, if you look at the net present value comparison, now what do you mean by net present value? The investment happens over years. You have to bring it back to today, keeping in mind the possible inflation. Okay, that is called as NPV or net present value. So for Tata Sumo, the costs are very low, the benefits are also not very high, but they are more than the costs. For luxury car, it's a larger number. For airships, there is a very, very huge cost, but also a very huge benefit. Okay, so summing up the numbers in rupees. So the fare that you will pay per passenger in Tata Sumo is around 3750 rupees. Luxury car 10,000. Airships 17,000 rupees. Okay. And if I assume that 7,000 rupees per trip, I am happy to pay for the comfort and the time saving, you are becoming equivalent to a luxury car. Okay. So then we did some sensitivity analysis. What happens? Suppose we say no revenue from advertisement and intangibles are less, then the airships will take much, much more years, 8 years for you to recover. Okay. So basically what it means is that the investment required when you want to operate airships is very high. Okay. So it's 250 times higher than compared to the SUVs and 35 times higher than compared to luxury car. So that means you need very deep pockets to take this risk. Okay. But if you include value of travel time, there can be a very, very strong argument. So if $100, 6,000 rupees per day is what you value as one day, then airships become attractive. Additional revenue can be also obtained using advertisement and product promotion. And the break-even point, whether it is 1 year or 8 years or 6 years, is a very strong function of the assumptions, obviously. So don't get swayed by 1 year and 8 years and all that. As I said, these numbers can change drastically with the change in the assumptions. Basic point is that investment may be needed of a high magnitude, but the returns are also of very high magnitude. So therefore, a risk taker can invest. And SUV needs the least time to break even, but also the revenues are very less. So SUV investment in SUV is the most conservative option. Investment in the airship will be a very, very bold option. Okay. So in conclusion, for Chardham Yatra, assuming that an airship can be made by improving something like Skyship 600B to handle the altitudes, a very big assumption, then it is feasible. Okay. Payback can come in the first year only for the airships, and third year for the Tata Sumo, and fourth year in luxury car. This is assuming that you earn a good amount of revenue from advertisement. Okay. And if you assume that there is no revenue from advertisement, and if you assume 90 rupees per hour only as the value of travel saving time, it takes 8 years for you to recover. So in a transportation system, especially when the investment comes in a large part from the government or from some other investor, if the recovery of your revenue in the worst case scenario happens in 8 years and in the best case scenario in 1 year, it's a very good case for investment. Okay. So this particular study was presented by me to Dr. Kalam when I met him in the year 2001. In fact, I am wrong. The study was done in the year 2000. And in 2001, we got the data. And in 2001 March, I had gone to New Delhi with Professor Sane, who was that time working in our department. We both met Dr. Kalam because we were proposing a project for study of use of airships in Uttaranchal. So this is the case study I presented. And at many places it got presented. The numbers, of course, can be questioned. I'm not saying that I would put my 1 rupee or 100 rupee in this venture based on these numbers. But we did this study essentially to satisfy ourselves whether this is an area worth getting into or not. The common perception people have is, oh, airships are very expensive. They will be, you know, you will take so many years, you will never be able to recover. So those numbers, of course, we have answered. Okay.